And you look back on your lives. Well, I can look back on my life, and I won't speak for you, but I look back on my life, at some of the most difficult times have been the times when I have grown most in God. Yeah? Those most difficult times have been the time that I have most grown in God. That doesn't mean that I seek difficult times, you know. Think, oh God, give me some more problems. But you see, God knows what is best for us. God wants what is best for us. God wanted what was best. And what is best is not always what is easiest.
This is GBC Web TV. On the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called Prevailing Prayer, Exodus 17 verses 1 to 18 verse 27. By Pastor David Wise.
But it is my observation that whilst a lot of the stories are very well known, we've looked already at the plagues, the Passover, the crossing of the Red Sea, many Christians don't understand the significance of these events and stories for themselves today. So we work as we go through these passages very hard to try and make sure that we apply it into today and understand God's word for us today. So, who was here last week? The place was full last week. I don't think there were just six of us here last week. So, some very shy people around. Okay. So, a recap. What were the main things that we learnt from last week? You remember that we picked the story up last week, the other side of the Red Sea. The people had crossed the Red Sea, they'd finished their big celebration, and they'd begun to go off into the wilderness. Looked at chapter 16 last week. What were the main lessons that we learnt last week? Dorothy?
God will provide our needs.
God will provide our needs, yes. What else?
God will not do by a miracle what he expects us to do by obedience.
Oh yeah, God will not do by miracle what he has decided to do through human obedience. Yes, what else? Yeah, hola.
Sometimes we have to go through bitter and sweet experiences.
Yes, sometimes in life there are bitter experiences. And as a part of that, we looked at faith cannot be known to be true until it's been tested. Remember we saw that last week? Faith cannot be known to be true until it's been tested. What else do we see out of the passage from last week? Anita?
When God does something, he's positive and he can't change his mind. It's very funny because he doesn't go back on what he said he's going to do. He sticks to what he says he's going
to do. Yeah, God sticks to what he says he's going to do. One of the other important things we saw last week about, remember, we looked at the provision of manna last week and quails, and we talked about daily bread. We talked about the fact that everything that we take for granted each day actually comes from God. Remember that? We talked about that. So, we're going to pick up the story. We're going to start at the beginning of chapter 17. We're going to look this morning at the whole of chapter 17 and chapter 18. So we're going to go through the passage over the next 50 minutes fairly rapidly. Chapter 17 and 18 this morning. Exodus 17 and verse 1. The whole Israelite community set out from the desert of Sin, traveling from place to place as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. So they quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses replied, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you put the Lord to the test?" But the people were thirsty for water there, and they grumbled against Moses. They said, "Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to make us and our children and our livestock die of thirst?" Moses cried to the Lord, "What am I to do with these people? They're almost ready to stone me." And the Lord answered Moses, "Walk on ahead of the people. Take with you some of the elders of Israel and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go." And I will stand there before you by the rock at Horeb, strike the rock, and water will come out of it for the people to drink. So Moses did this in the sight of the elders of Israel. And he called the place Massah and Meribah because the Israelites quarreled and because they tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" Well, once again, and this is going to be a pattern throughout Exodus, we find the people complaining. Now, before we dismiss their lack of faith too quickly, I want us just to reflect a little bit upon their situation, because these events were recorded, as we looked at last week, so that we actually can understand something of our journey in the Christian faith. Now, they were in between being set free from slavery and arriving in the promised land. A bit like us, really. We've been set free because of Jesus' activity in our lives, set free to become all that God's created us to be, but we've not arrived at the promised land yet, have we? So we're in that in-between time. Their journey was through the wilderness, but they were following God's route. This journey through the wilderness was God's route for them. This lack of easy water was God's doing. Like us in our faith journey, as we journey with God. You know, God could choose to make our lives really easy. God can do anything. He's all powerful, all knowing. And he could look at Andy and say, "I'm going to make Andy's life, everywhere he walks, there's going to be rose petals on the ground in front of him. Everything he wants is going to be given to him. Life will be absolutely easy and straightforward and simple. He'll never need anything, never need to ask for anything. He'll be blessed in every single possible way." But God hasn't done that for Andy, and God isn't going to do that for Andy. Why is that? Why does God not make our lives completely and totally difficulty-free? Yeah.
That we may rely on him.
So that we can rely on him and trust him. Yes, Susan.
Because we'd forget about him if everything was so given.
We'd forget about him. Yeah, if everything was so easy and straightforward, we would just forget about God. Joan.
Somehow we need the struggle.
We need the struggle. Why do we need the struggle, Joan?
Because struggle, physical struggle, makes for fitness.
Yeah.
And spiritual struggle, hopefully, makes for spiritual fitness.
So physical struggle makes for physical fitness. We had a men's discipleship day away yesterday. The Men Behaving Godly men's discipleship group had a day away yesterday. And among the lots of spiritual activities, but one or two other things as well, including relay racing and arm wrestling. Wayne, stand up, Wayne. Wayne, it won't surprise you to know, won the arm wrestling. But you see, you get physical strength through physical struggle and exercise and doing stuff like that. If we didn't exert ourselves, didn't do anything, we would have no strength. And spiritually, it's just the same. It's as we struggle, as we engage with a broken world, as we engage with difficulty, so we become spiritually stronger. And God is forming this people, this ragbag of slaves that have been brought out of Egypt, out of their oppression. He's forming them into a people, a nation that can trust in him. So he takes them through the wilderness. And they have to struggle. They have to trust God. They have to have faith. And it's out of this. This is why this book is so significant in the Old Testament, because it is the creation of God's people. And you look back on your lives. Well, I can look back on my life, and I won't speak for you, but I look back on my life, and some of the most difficult times have been the times when I have grown most in God. Yeah? Those most difficult times have been the time that I have most grown in God. Now, that doesn't mean that I seek difficult times, you know. Think, oh, God, give me some more problems. But you see, God knows what is best for us. God wants what is best for us. God wanted what was best. And what is best is not always what is easiest. You know that with your own children, those of you that have got small children. What is best for them is often what is not what is easiest. Do you understand that? You know that, don't you, as parents? I see one or two parents grinning from ear to ear. They understand that. God, as our Father, understands that for us. What is easiest is not necessarily what is for best. But one of the things that people did here was a wrong thing. Something they had to learn wasn't the way to behave. They tested the Lord. And this is about trying to force God's hand. Trying to make God act. And it reduces God to a level of becoming our servant. I wonder if you can think of some examples, maybe from, not necessarily from your own life, but the sort of things that Christians might be tempted to do today to force God's hand. One of the temptations that came to Jesus from Satan, do you remember? It was take yourself up on the top of the temple, throw yourself off, and God will send his angels to catch you. Yeah? Come on, Jesus, force God's hand. It's a temptation from Satan. I don't think Satan tempts us to go and climb onto Greenford Baptist Church roof and throw ourselves off to see how many angels will come and catch us. But what are the other temptations that might come our way to try and force God's hand? What sort of things? Yeah, Belinda.
This one is an extreme case. It was meant to be a man of God in Nigeria, and he said he could go into the lion's den in the zoo and nothing would happen to him.
Okay.
And he did, and of course he was ripped apart.
Okay. So is this man of God wanted to force God's hand by, you know, reenacting the lion's den, but God had other ideas and he went to heaven slightly quicker than he'd anticipated. Okay, yeah. Other examples, Rachel.
Just one I read recently, you know, apparently, it's true, but the ministers have the highest pilot's insurance if they're a pilot because they're more likely to go into a storm saying, God will look after them. You
know, okay, so this is aircraft pilots, okay.
Yeah, but I mean, the same driving, would it be more like to sort of think, you know, well, I can go into this dangerous situation because God's going to be with me, it's not me.
Okay, so it's about, for some people, this temptation to take risks, things that we didn't ought to be doing, things rather than doing what is the right thing to do, and saying, well, you know, we're trusting God, God's going to look after us. And of course, you may remember there was one very famous Christian leader whose plane crashed because it was a 6-seater plane and he put 15 people on it and trusted God and they all died. And that's an example of forcing God's hand. Yeah. What are the ways about putting God to the test here?
Giving lots of money with the anticipation of being blessed.
Yeah. I mean, I received, somebody brought me a letter, actually, they'd received a little while ago from a well-known ministry. And this letter basically said, you know, you give, I forget what it was, so many pounds to God, and God will give you 7 times back. You know, that's reducing God to a slot machine. You know, you put your £7 in here, pull the handle, you take your £49 out the bottom. That's testing God. God blesses us. God chooses to bless us, but not because we deserve it, because no matter how much we do, we never deserve it. Okay, so we mustn't test God. A couple more examples. Joan.
I've heard examples of people with a medical condition want God to heal them, give up using their medication.
Okay, so someone with a medical condition trying to say to God, you're going to heal me, I'm going to stop taking my medication. If you don't heal me, I'm going to die or I'm going to do whatever. Okay. All right, okay. And they had to learn that this, you know, this is not how you treat God, because it reduces God. It makes us the boss. We are setting the rules for God. And we don't do that to the creator and sustainer of the universe. Sometimes God in his mercy will fish us out. Because he's a merciful God. But we can't require him to do that. Are you with me? So we mustn't test God in this sense of testing that is used here. Okay, let's move on to the next story here. verse 8. The Amalekites came and attacked the Israelites at Rephidim. Moses said to Joshua, first reference to Joshua, by the way, he becomes a significant leader in Israel later on, but this is the first reference to him. Choose some of our men and go out and fight the Amalekites. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the staff of God in my hands. So Joshua fought the Amalekites as Moses had ordered. Aaron and Hur went to the top of the hill. As long as Moses held up his hands, the Israelites were winning. But whenever he lowered his hands, the Amalekites were winning. When Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and Hur held his hands up, one on one side, one on the other, so that his hands remained steady until sunset. So Joshua overcame the Amalekite army with the sword. Then the Lord said to Moses, write this on a scroll as something to be remembered, and make sure that Joshua hears it, because I will completely blot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven. Moses built an altar and he called it, the Lord is my banner. He said, for hands were lifted up to the throne of the Lord. The Lord will be at war against the Amalekites from generation to generation. What can we learn from this? Well, the Amalekites were a nomadic people. They lived in the wilderness. They moved around there. They probably felt that Israel, which was a large company, was a threat because they'd come into their space. And they were consuming scarce wilderness resources. And so they came and they attacked. This wasn't the only occasion. There were other occasions also. And Moses goes and stands on this hill and he raises his hands. And when his hands are raised, the Israelite warriors on the ground are victorious. And when they are dropped, they are not so. The Amalekites prevail. Now, there's been a huge amount of writing and speculation about this, and I'm not going to unpack all of that. But I want to suggest two things. I recognize that there are other interpretations and there are difficulties with some of the things that I'm going to suggest. But there are two things that it seems to me quite probably are going on here, which both seem rather relevant to us in the light of what we have been doing here this morning in preparation for setting out the healing zone in the heart of our community next week as we pray for people to know God's healing spiritually, physically, emotionally, and mentally. Jews prayed, the people of God prayed with their arms raised, their hands raised to heaven. It was the attitude of prayer. They always stood, they always had their arms raised. And when they'd finished praying, they put their arms down. So one of the things here that is going on, I think, is that Moses was praying. He was interceding for the people of God in the battle on the ground. The second thing that is going on here is Moses was up on a hill. He would have been visible to the fighters. There was a prophetic action, I think, going on here. You know, when Moses struck the rock with the staff, the water came out. Previously, he'd struck the Nile with the staff. Do you remember? And the water turned to blood. This was the reverse, the striking of the rock to bring fresh water out. He'd raised his hand and the staff when they crossed the Red Sea and the waters parted. It's a prophetic symbolism of God's activity, God being at work. And as the fighters saw that action, knowing that Moses was there interceding with God, and the prophetic action, we know that Moses was a prophet. There was a release of God's power. There was encouragement for the people on a human, physical level. But there also was a release of God's power into the people. The parallel towards next week seems to me to be very obvious. Now, here's an interesting question. Which do you think was most important? The fighters on the ground or the prayers and the prophetic people on the hill? Who was most important? Prayer. Yeah, neither. You're absolutely right. Because if people were just praying, nothing would be happening on the ground. If people were just on the ground, they would have been defeated because there was no power. So when we come to next Saturday and the carnival, whatever your role is going to be, and you all have a role, we want to see the whole of the church family next week out at Greenford Carnival. You don't all have to be there for all 8 hours, but we want all of you there for some of the time. Every one of you. And it doesn't matter whether you are handing out leaflets, whether you are talking to people, or whether you are praying hands-on for people for healing, or whether you are praying for the people who are praying. Every role is equally important. It's not that the praying people, those laying hands on people and praying for people, it's not that they're the most important, because they're not. None of it happens if the whole lot doesn't happen together. Are you with me here? You see that here. You see the importance of prayer. That's why we've done what we've done prophetically this morning. That's why we're having prayer meetings starting tonight, every night this week, 6:30 today, 8 o'clock Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Friday we're hoping to go down to Ravenna Park itself and pray in the park. If you can't be at one of those prayer meetings, you're at home looking after children, Richard, stand up. Get a copy of the prayer diary from Richard this morning. Stand up, Richard. This is Richard. He will give you a written copy. Or you can go to our website. It's on the front page of our website. You can download it. You can see what the prayer subject is for the day. So if you are physically prevented from being here, I will not be able to be here Monday to Friday this week. But every evening I will be praying as you are praying. Taking the prayer diary with me. I have, since January, a week away that has been planned where I'm going to be elsewhere this week. And this was arranged afterwards and I've not been able to change it. But I'm going to be praying every day. I'll be here tonight, but I'll be praying on every other evening as well with that prayer diary. And if you can't be here, that's no excuse for not praying. We want you to be here if you possibly can, but if you can't be here, you have that prayer diary on our website, physical copy, hard copy from Richard, and you pray. And then next Saturday, everyone involved. And every role is equally important. This phrase at the end here, the Lord is my banner. A banner's not a terribly good, it's the word that the NIV uses. It's not a terribly good word. A better word, I think, would be the Lord is my standard. Used in the military sense of that term. The standard was the, if you were in Boys and Girls Brigade, of course, any of you from years ago, you'd know all about the standard. The standard was the flag that was the rallying point in the fight. It was the marker. So the Lord is my rallying point. He's my standard. The Lord is my banner. Doesn't quite, in modern way that banner is used, quite have that same impact. But the Lord is my standard. He's my rallying point. He's my strength here. And that, of course, is our cry and our prayer all the time. So let's go on to the next part of the story, chapter 18. Now Jethro, the priest of Midian and father-in-law of Moses, heard of everything God had done for Moses and for his people Israel, and how the Lord had brought Israel out of Egypt. After Moses had sent away his wife Zipporah, and his father-in-law Jethro received her and her two sons. One son was named Gershom, for Moses said, "I've become an alien in a foreign land." And the other was named Eleazar, for he said, "My father's God was my helper. He saved me from the sword of Pharaoh." Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, together with Moses' son and wife, came to him in the desert where he was camped near the mountain of God. And Jethro had sent word to him, "I, your father-in-law Jethro, am coming to you with your wife and your two sons." Now, we don't know the circumstances of Moses' wife's departure. We can speculate, perhaps it was for her and their son's safety while Moses took on Pharaoh. Moses risked his life as he took on Pharaoh, as we've seen in the story previously. And maybe the wife and children were sent away for safety. We don't know, but that's a possibility. But this records their return, accompanied by her father. And this is what happened when they came back. Verse 7. Moses went out to meet his father-in-law and bowed down and kissed him. They greeted each other and then went into the tent. Moses told his father-in-law about everything the Lord had done to Pharaoh and the Egyptians for Israel's sake, and about all the hardships that they had met along the way and how the Lord had saved them. And Jethro was delighted to hear about all the good things the Lord had done for Israel in rescuing them from the hand of the Egyptians. He said, "Praise be to the Lord who rescued you from the hand of the Egyptians and of Pharaoh, and who rescued you from the hand of the Egyptians. Now I know that the Lord is greater than all the other gods, for he did this to those who had treated Israel arrogantly." Then Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, brought a burnt offering and other sacrifices to God. And Aaron came with all the elders of Israel to eat bread with Moses' father-in-law in the presence of God. Now this passage shows Jethro, who'd previously been a priest of Midian, becoming a worshipper of the Lord. And became a worshipper of the Lord in response to hearing Moses' testimony about all that God had done. Now, we didn't do it this morning because we want to do other things, but as a regular part of our Sunday morning meeting, we give opportunity for testimony. Telling of what God has done in our lives. Now, who here has got something that God has done in their life? Just put your hand up. I'm not going to ask you to say anything, but something that God has done in their life. Well, that's just about everybody. So you've all got a story to tell about God, haven't you? When did you last tell someone who didn't know God the story? I wonder when you last told someone who didn't know God, who doesn't know God, the story. It's one of the most powerful things that we have to tell other people. The story of how God has worked in our lives. And the stories are different. I mean, many of you in the room here, I've heard your story, I know your story. Some of you, dramatic lives involved in all sorts of different things. Others of you, lives that perhaps on the surface are more ordinary, but your experience of God is just as profound. God's power in your life, changing your circumstances, bringing healing and wholeness, bringing relationship with Him, helping you through difficult times. We've all got a story to tell. And as Jethro sat down and he listened to Moses talk about how God had intervened to bring the nation of Israel out of Egypt, the plagues, the Passover, the crossing of the Red Sea. Great story. Your story is just as powerful. Because there was a time when you did not know God, wasn't there? Time you didn't know God. And then there was a time. For some of you, it was over a series, a period of time. For others of you, there was a moment you can look back on, a day, where God broke into your life. And then since that point, God's been at work in your life. Yeah, there's been ups and there's been downs. But there have been so many times that you can talk about God being at work in your life. You've got a story to tell. Testimony. Amen? Amen. Why didn't you look this week to tell someone, maybe at work, maybe at college, maybe a neighbour, maybe a friend, maybe a relative? Look this week for an opportunity to tell them something that God has done in your life. Do we agree to try and do that this week? Yeah? Amen? Look for an opportunity to share one aspect of your story, not your whole life story, okay? Particularly if it's at work, not your whole life story, but one thing that God has done for you. Share that with somebody around you who doesn't know Jesus this week. You can invite them to the carnival as well if you want to. Come to the healing zone. Come and find God's power released in your life. But let's take that opportunity this week. You're all this week going to rub shoulders with people that don't know Jesus. In fact, I remember Steve some time ago now, before the church was as big as this, we did a calculation about how many people between us, how many non-Christians we have conversation with in a week. And I can't remember the final number, but it was thousands between us. And that was before there were as many of us as there are now. Lots of opportunities. Because people need good news. So much bad news around. People need good news. Good news about how God provides for his people. You can look back on times, many of you, when you were struggling financially. I look back in my mind, I've got a particular situation back in my mind when just after our second child was born, we were in difficulties financially. It's one of those situations, the mortgage rate had gone up massively, even more than it is now, makes the 5% of now look like peanuts. Back to that time when, do you remember mortgage rates, 17%? Remember that? We're in that period. We didn't have enough money to pay the gas bill, the electricity bill, to deal with things. We had more money going out than we had coming in. And we sought God. And we got a letter in the post with a cheque drawn on a trust, which I'd never heard of. Quite a substantial amount of money that helped us right the way through that period till the time that Leslie was able to start working again. To this day, I don't know where it came from. I've got my theories, but I don't actually know where it came from. It came from God, but who was the human source? There was someone that listened to God, someone that God told us. We didn't share our situation. No one knew our situation, in fact. But God did, and God said to someone, my servant David Wise is in difficulty. I want you to bless him. There are people around us in difficulties. Share our testimonies about how God provides for us. Bringing healing and wholeness and provision in our lives. And as that testimony came, Jethro became a worshipper of the Lord. You can follow the pattern through here. He comes along to God's house, the tabernacle. And he ends up actually worshipping God, making offering to God. This week, look for opportunities to tell your testimony of what God is doing in your life. And let's come on to this last passage. We'll quite long, these next 14 verses. We'll read it through in one go. And then make some reflections. The next day, Moses took his seat to serve as judge for the people. And they stood around him from morning till evening. When his father-in-law saw all that Moses was doing for the people, he said, "What is this that you are doing for the people? Why do you alone sit as judge while all these people stand around you from morning till evening?" And Moses answered him, "Because the people come to me to seek God's will. Whenever they have a dispute, it is brought to me. and I decide between the parties and inform them of God's decrees and laws. And Moses' father-in-law replied, what you are doing is not good. You and these people who come to you will only wear yourselves out. The work is too heavy for you. You cannot handle it alone. Listen now to me and I will give you some advice, and may God be with you. You must be the people's representative before God and bring their disputes to him. Teach them the decrees and laws. Show them the way to live and the duties they are to perform. But select capable men from all the people, men who fear God, trustworthy men who hate dishonest gain, and appoint them as officials over thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. Have them serve as judges for the people at all times, but have them bring every difficult case to you. The simple cases they can decide themselves. That will make your load lighter, because they will share it with you. If you do this and God so commands, you'll be able to stand the strain and all these people will go home satisfied. Moses listened to his father-in-law and did everything he said. He chose capable men from all Israel and made them leaders of the people, officials over thousands, hundreds and fifties and tens. And they served as judges for the people at all times. The difficult cases they brought to Moses, but the simple ones they decided themselves. Then Moses sent his father-in-law on his way, and Jethro returned to his own country. Jethro observed that not only was Moses burning himself out, he was wearing the people out too. Because people had to wait in line for so long to see him. Can you just imagine it? One person, there were thousands and thousands of Israelites. It's a bit like some of those queues you see sometimes on the TV for something or other. You've got people waiting in line all day in the heat, in the dryness. And they still don't get seen. They come back the next day, and the next day, and the next day. And the people are getting worn out. Not only Moses that's getting worn out. He was solely responsible for giving guidance on God's will, on God's purpose, on God's law, and sorting out all the disagreements. Because people disagree sometimes, don't they? Don't know if you notice that. And Jethro saw that there was a need for others to be released to do these things. Moses picking up things that others couldn't do. One of the things that's really striking here for me about Moses' character, great shift from where he was early on. Do you remember when he killed the Egyptian? He acted entirely on his own, actually without God. He thought, God's called me to do this, I'm going to do it. I'm going to take it on single-handed. I'm going to sort the world out. Complete disaster. Here, Moses actually listens to Jethro and realizes that there are others, other people of faith, other people of integrity who could share the load with him. And that was better for him and it was better for the people. So when we look at that, what can we learn? There was in that situation a need for others to be released to do Moses' work. What can we learn about God's people? Because we are God's people in a similar way to the people of Israel were God's people at that time. What can we learn for us today? What are the lessons? There's some big lessons here. Sorry, Wayne.
I think we need to learn to trust each other a bit more.
Okay, so it's about trusting each other a bit more. Okay, yeah. Andy?
Not to try and do everything yourself. If you've got a task, there are others who can help you.
Okay, so not to try. If we've got a task, whatever that task is, not to think we have to do it all by ourselves, but to draw in others to do that, because that's good for us and it's good for others as well. I mean, how do you think it was, just in passing, for these people, you know, these leaders of hundreds, thousands, tens, they were capable people and they were just standing around all day. And then when Moses began to share the task with them, They've suddenly got a role. They've suddenly got significance. They've got function. They're able to use the gifts that God had put in them. So, yeah, not to keep it all. What else? Okay, so important that we use the gifts that God has given us. How many of you, this is a little bit of a recap here from a sermon a few weeks ago. How many of you are gifted by God? If you're a Christian and you haven't got your hand up, you are wrong. Put your hand down. Because every one of you, remember when we looked at this a few weeks ago, it's on the internet, if you haven't seen it, you weren't here. Every one of us, by virtue of the fact that we are part of God's family, is gifted by God. Amen? Amen. Every one of us. So all of us need to be using our gifts. What else can we learn from this? Yeah.
It's good to listen to God's counsel.
I didn't catch that, I'm sorry.
Listen to God's counsel, because we knew from the story that Jethro was also, he actually worshipped God, and that Moses also listened to his father-in-law because he knew he could listen to
him. Ah, so it's important we listen to God's counsel. Thank you, Hannah. What else? Joan?
Moses had, to a certain extent, to relinquish control, didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
He'd always been the one, and everybody coming to him, and there's a certain status in that, even though it was wearing him out. He had to take his hands off.
So Moses had to relinquish control to take his hands off. But there's something else. On the other side, I'm going to pick on you, Joan, because, you know, you're part of the leadership here, so I can pick on you. So what was the other side of that? Moses had to take his hands off and relinquish control, and
other people had to pick up what he had been doing.
Okay, other people had to pick up what he'd been doing, and there's something else. Adam.
Not the congregation, but the people had to realise that these other people that had been gifted and they...
Ah. They had to recognise that there were other people that they could go to, other people that had been gifted. They didn't have to... You know, they've been standing in line for Moses, and now actually there were other people, and they had to be willing to go to other people. And it's back what... Wayne, my brain's gone dead this morning. What Wayne was saying earlier on about us trusting one another. Carol.
Yeah, Moses had to realise that just as he was chosen and he had specific gifting from God to do that, that God had chosen others, and each individual person has got very just individual gifts just made for that job that only that person can do. Moses couldn't do what the other people could do.
Absolutely. So Moses and the people had to recognise that there were things that other people could do that Moses couldn't do. That he wasn't. Akin.
I think it shows us that we've all got a role to play, and we just don't rely on one person. We're all in it together.
We're all in it together. Every single person has a role to play. Ehi.
It also shows that there is a responsibility for the leaders to train people and develop them. Because if you see, there's a place there where he said Moses... how to teach the people the rules and the decrees. So you need to teach them before you delegate that responsibility to them.
So one of the things is the role of leadership to train and delegate. So to go back to Andy's point when earlier on about involving other people, part of the role of doing that as you involve other people is actually to impart the information and knowledge that they need, to be training them. I think that everyone who has a role in church family should, as a part of that role, be training other people to do it. Whatever your role is, whatever your place is, whatever your function in church family is, I think part of God's calling on you is to train other people to do it. Amen?
Amen.
Whatever it is. It used to be just Andy up behind the screen up here, doing the filming, the projector, doing the filming. Andy has trained someone else to do that. So last week... Now, when we started recording these meetings, when Andy wasn't here, didn't get recorded. But last week's was recorded because Andy had trained somebody else, Philip, to do that. And Philip and Andy are going to be training other people also. Did you see the principle that is here? And that ought to be a part of what we're doing all the time, all the time. As I was preparing for this, I was reminded also of of another aspect of our particular situation here at Greenford Baptist Church. If you're a member of the church or you read the notices, you will remember that the church family here have made a decision that we're going to seek to appoint a full-time assistant for me starting this autumn. Do you remember that? We made that decision. We're going to seek to do that. And church members will know, if they listen carefully to the meeting, that we were hoping and are still hoping to make an announcement about that on Sunday the 6th of July, which is next Sunday. So do be praying about that, because we hope that, we don't know certainly yet, but we hope that next Sunday we will have an announcement to make about that next Sunday, as we seek in this process of looking to appoint somebody to work alongside me, a pastor's assistant here at Greenford Baptist Church. So let's think about this morning. Let's try and draw these things together. Our time has nearly gone this morning. Let's try and pull these things together that have come out of this passage we've looked at, these two chapters. What are the key things that we're going to take away into this week and beyond from these two chapters that we've looked at this morning? What are the key things? Andy?
Action and prayer are both equally important.
Okay, action and prayer, equally important. Well, prayer is action, but I know what you mean. So, yeah, absolutely.
Spiritual struggle toughens, it doesn't kill.
Mm-hmm, I like that. Spiritual struggle toughens, it doesn't kill. Rachel?
On the same part of the talk, but reminded me of a verse in the Bible. It says, suffering produces perseverance, character, and character hope, and hope doesn't disappoint us.
Okay, suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance produces character. Character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint. So, yeah, very much so. Yes?
God's timing is perfect. His direction is right. And the result from God is so right.
Okay, God's timing is perfect. His direction is right. And the result is absolutely right. Because God knows what he's doing with us. Yeah. Amen?
Amen.
Belinda, second bite.
And in God's house, the leaders of the church should recognize different gifts of people and use it to build the house of God.
So among God's people, the leaders have a responsibility to recognize, to train and release other people's gifting within the church family. Yes. Frank?
We mustn't test God.
Yeah, we mustn't test God. We need to. God tests our faith. We don't test his faithfulness by trying to set him up to say, yeah, I'm going to do this, God, you catch me. Joan.
Something interesting I've just noticed. Jethro had just come to faith as far as he could, and yet he was able to make a huge input into the organisation of the whole church family, because not church family, the family of God.
Very
and,
good.
Moses needed his input, and yet he'd only just
so Jethro was the newest community member, and yet he was the one that God spoke through that brought transformation in the community.
Amen.
And then he went off again.
Yeah. You know, sometimes in some church families, you feel like you've got to be there for 50 years before you can make any contribution. I exaggerate, but, you know, it's recognizing that even the newest person, God can use, God can speak through. As I was looking through, there were four things that seemed to me to be the key things out of this morning. You know, God can take us through a wilderness. God sometimes chooses to do that. Now, others might be depending on our prayers. If Moses had decided, that's it, I'm not going to pray anymore today. So others, this week, church, you're called to pray this week. Other people are depending on your prayers. Our testimony of God is powerful. And delegation is a divine principle. And I mean it's a divine principle because God could actually do everything in the world without us. I mean, God doesn't need you, doesn't need me, could do it all directly. But God chooses to invest in you, to train you, to equip you, to release you, because you are the body of Christ. It's a divine principle. We need to be seeing that at work. Let's stand together. Let's pray together as we finish this morning. I'm going to give you a moment quiet. There may be something that you silently want to say to God, first of all, and then I'm going to commit us to God in prayer. Father God, we thank you for these true accounts of you working with your people many thousands of years ago in the wilderness. We thank you for Moses. We thank you for Jethro. But Father, thank you that these principles are true for us. And I ask that you'll help us as we go into this week to take these things with us. Father, I ask that you'll help us to keep our excited word earlier this morning, to share our testimony this week with someone who doesn't know you, to tell them the good news about what you've been doing in our lives. Help us, Father, this week to be faithful in prayer as we pray towards next Saturday. We pray for our community, wanting to see a release of God's power, your spirit, healing and wholeness into our community. Father God, I commit us together now, afresh to you. Ask that you'll pour your spirit, continue to pour your spirit on us, in us, and through us. That wherever we are this week, whether we're at work, whether we're at home, whether we're with family, whether we're with friends, whether we're at college, wherever we are this week, that we will make a difference for you. We will be salt and light. We will be channels for refreshing. We will be the place where heaven meets earth. In our context and situations, that we will make a difference for you wherever we are, whatever we're doing. In Jesus' name, amen. Please sit down.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.